Hi everyone, so we'll continue with our behavioral design patterns and finish the class. So we talked about the communication strategies that are basically solved through the design patterns, the behavioral design patterns. And we talked about the strategy design pattern, the template method design pattern, and the observer design pattern. We'll continue today with the command design pattern, the iterator design pattern, and the state or a state machine automata-based design pattern. So the first one is the command design pattern. And mainly it was motivated by graphical user interfaces, but you can think about it as any kind of situations in which you want a single string to motivate, to be assigned to multiple different ways to access a certain data. So basically, let's consider that you have a graphical user interface and you want the same function to be triggered by many different means, a keystroke or a menu bar or a button or any kind or radio button, a checkbox, any kind of component that basically results into that same result. And I can actually show you an example to know exactly what I mean. This was supposed to start. Yes, and it did start. So basically, I have a graphical user interface, a very simple graphical user interface that has both a menu that allows one to choose the color of the font of the background, and it has buttons that allows one to choose the color of the background. So basically you have multiple means of changing the color of the background. And this is exactly what the design pattern, the command design pattern does. So basically you want to encode multiple similar events into the same listener, and you want multiple components to trigger that same listener. And the way to do it is to incorporate all of the information concerning the command into an abstract separate object called the command object. In many cases, this command object is a string. So basically a string will encode what will be the effect in this application. But in many other cases, the command can be actually an object like in Java, an object instance of a class, or even one of the members of an enumeration that basically specifies what is the command, what is the action that will be taken based on a object representation, on a single object representation. So the common approach for the common pattern, for the command design pattern, is to specify a string for each command, have one listener respond to every one of these commands differently. So it's really you are encoding the command, the action that you want to be executed as a string. It ensures that all the commands are handled in a uniform way because there is a single listener listening for those commands, and they are also executing the commands in the same way. There are no differences between listeners because there is a single listener. These commands don't have to be hard-coded. They can also be specified inside the text file to specify what are basically the actions taken for every one of these commands. And I will start with a simple interface. Consider that you have a graphical user interface. You have one colored panel, like for instance, the background of the current panel. And you have two buttons, yellow and red, that allow you to modify the color of the background, or you have two menu items, yellow and red, that again, clicking on them will change the color of the panel. And since the buttons and the menu items perform the same function, they should be tied to the same commands, to the same listener. So basically you have multiple different components, graphical user interface components that allow you to actually modify in the same way, the panel. And I can have pop-up menus or other means to change the colors, keystrokes, yellow, Y, or red for R, R for red. So basically, you want to encode in a single listener all of these ways to interact with that panel. And that's basically what I'm doing in this Java Swing application. I have a frame which contains basically the multiple issues that we wanted. We have two buttons for yellow and red. We have a menu bar that contains two options, menu items, yellow menu item and red menu item. I encode into two different strings, yellow command and red command. You see that basically they are strings, final, static, final string. You can actually even pass them as an enumeration of these are the possible values that the command can take. Or you can basically just pass them as strings, yellow command as a string and red command as a string. Then you basically construct the interface. So you initialize the buttons, you initialize the pop-up menu, initialize the menu. Then in the init buttons, you basically specify the set, the action, set action command is the method that will be executed for the different colors, yellow command or red command. And then you basically add the listeners to the different buttons, components on the screen, the yellow button, the red button, or the menu items. And you add all of the panels to the current window, to the current frame. Similarly, you are basically adding the action listeners for the pop-up items in the menu, yellow pop-up item and the red pop-up item. And you are basically afterwards, you can also define mouse listeners that basically identify the same commands or other commands. Finally, in action perform, we actually have the event listener. So one thing that you may have noticed is my class is not only the frame itself, which is the window in Swing, but also the action listener itself. So this last method, action performed, is in fact the action, the method that takes an action event, and based on the command that is passed into this action event, if it's yellow, it sets the background of the current panel, color panel, to yellow. If it's red, it sets it to red, or any other command. So the idea is that you actually have one single listener, but it listens to many different components, and these components pass the command that the action to be executed as a string. That's the whole point of the command design pattern, that the command design pattern encodes an action as a string, but not also only as a string. In some cases, you actually want to encode it as an action, as a command object. So consider a different example. During this pandemic, in fact, I had to fix the garage door. We bought actually a house, our first house, and of course the garage door was broken. And you can consider that a command is actually a way to interact with different components, different objects in the garage, robot objects like the garage door, the light, and so on. So we have one interface, which basically is the command interface and has one single execute action. And then you have classes like the garage door is basically the object, object that needs to be interacted with and has methods for opening the garage door or closing the garage door and showing the status. Then the garage door open command executes a single method, which is the execute method, and it implements the command interface. And basically it's it interacts with the garage door. In the case that I call execute on the garage door open command, it opens the garage and shows the status. Similarly, we may have a second interface, a class, the light on command that implements command, which actually interacts with the light in the garage. So we have the on function, the off function, and the toggle function, which basically toggles from on to off, false to true. And the execute method for this light on command is basically turns on the light and shows the status after basically we execute this the command. So now we can actually implement a simple remote command. So this simple remote command pattern basically takes as a parameter the command object. So now you see that it's not a string, it's actually a command object. And for this command object, when the button is pressed on this remote, it executes. So usually the remotes for garage doors are simple one button remotes. So you only press one button, and what it basically does, it encodes whatever that remote was configured for. So I'm creating a remote in the main method. I'm setting the command to be the light on command for the new light object. And when the button is pressed for this remote, it basically turns on the light. Again, if I set a different command, the garage door opener command for the garage door, again, the idea is that button pressed will actually execute opening the garage door. So the difference is between this and the previous example, the one with the colors, is that the command doesn't have to be a string. In some cases, it's an object with properties and maybe a complex state. You can also implement opener closer, because basically all that you need to do is to, instead of calling, like in the case of light on, you can actually call toggle. So basically it opens and closes the garage by a single remote button, and the command sends which command is going to be executed, the light or the garage. So really the idea of the command pattern is that you have a single execution way, and with this one execution way, you can actually interact with a command object to open the door or close the door. The next design pattern that I want to cover today is the iterator design pattern. And you're already familiar with the iterator design pattern from Java. It's used for traversing a container and accessing the container's elements. In the case that you have to perform some operation on a sequence of elements given a data structure. In fact, it's used in many different places in a programming language. Like for instance, in Java, is used on all the containers that are in the Java collections framework. So it works on array lists, on queues, on linked lists, on any kind of container, on hash maps. Then it also works on input-output streams. So basically the same way that you would iterate through a collection, you would iterate over the inputs, next, has next, and next, to read the inputs from the command prompt. It also works for string tokenizer interface. So basically it lets you to iterate over all tokens, individual words, inside the string. So it decouples the algorithm from what is actually the container that you want to implement. Is it a tree or a graph? It actually allows you to iterate in the same way over any type of container. And it does this by maintaining inside this iterator the state, or basically the cursor in the container. It keeps track of the current item and basically has a way to identify the elements in the original data structure. An iterator produces basically the elements for processing. Using an iterator has to be a simple interface that standardizes how do you actually iterate over the elements, no matter what's the collection. For instance, an update method for all the elements in a list. It's easy to write. You can basically create an iterator for that list, given that the list implements the iterable interface. And you basically can write a for loop that iterates with it.next to get the next element, call the method update, and then check if there is a next element, if it has it has a next element. It makes the iteration through the elements at a very high level. You don't need actually to know, is this a tree, and you parse it or you iterate over the tree in a prefix way or an in order way or post order way. you basically, as long as the iterator has that internal state that states how are the elements traversed, you can basically do it through two methods, hasNext and next. Makes the iteration, as I said, the higher level, and separates the production of the objects, iterating over the objects, from the operation that you actually want to implement on these objects. So it's a way to standardize iteration over collections. Most common classes in Java API are using iterators, and I enumerated those: vector, ArrayList, HashMap, HashSet. Input-output streams also work as like iterators. They have asNext and next. String tokenizers have iterators. Basically, the problem of iterating is that there is a complex way to define an iterator, but once you define the iterator, and you basically can easily traverse it. The solution for actually implementing such complex iterators is to actually create a second data structure, like an array or a list, that basically represents the elements in the original table. Usually this is an array of or a list of references to the actual elements in the original data structure. The reason why you are actually creating this array is that now you can easily iterate over the elements, because you are iterating over the elements in this array, not in the original data structure. You don't have to remember that I'm looking in order or any other way. You can actually collect through an in order traversal the elements from the tree and then come back into the iterator and iterate over the elements of this traversal of an array that represents the traversal. The java.util iterator interface basically implements three methods. HasNext returns Boolean, returns true if I started in this collection and there are still more elements to iterate over. Next, actually, if there are more elements to iterate over, based on the current cursor, it returns the next one. It also modifies the state of the current object to record that we actually moved over the current element, and now the next will be another next element. Finally, iterator also added the method remove, which allows you to actually remove from the original collection an element using the iterator interface. Java before 1.2 also provided another interface called enumeration, which had methods like has more elements, has next element to iterate over the collections or any collection. The advantage of iterator is really that it's newer, has shorter method names, has a remove method that allows you to remove elements from the original collection during iteration, and is basically recommended for any new implementations. So, and here is an example. For instance, I have a class payroll, and the class payroll has employees, and I basically store them in an array. You can store them into an array list or anything else that you would want, a hash map with the key being the name of the employee and so on. We should provide, if we want an iterator, to actually have a method getIterator that would give us a new generator for iterators. Such a generator has to implement the iterator interface. And then we can basically, let's say that there was a pandemic like the one that we are now, and we need to have all of us take 10% decrease in salary. So we can basically decrease all payroll method will take the iterator for that payroll. And then there it has standard methods to iterate over the collection. While the iterator has next is true, we take the next employee with it.next, and then the salary of that employee, and we set the salary for that employee to 90% of their original salary. So everybody basically takes overall 10% salary decrease. So that's the use of an iterator, and this is standard use of iterators for any kind of data structures and your own classes. Now, such an employee iterator basically has to iterate over the original collection. And usually the way to do it is, I will show you two different ways. One that uses an array list as the original data structure, and one that uses an array. So for an array, it's quite simple. You start with n being a local private integer variable that states that this current element that we are currently looking at is zero. Has next only checks that n is less than the number of employees. This is an inner class to the payroll class. So the number of employees is actually available to the inner object because it's over the object that we actually already have the outer object access to it. The next method basically first checks if the number of employees is n is still less than the number of employees. The object variable is assigned employees of n. We increment with one the index, and then we return the object. So it returns the next object in the iteration using basically a reference to that object. If there are no such objects, because we are basically now out of the bounds of the array, we basically throw an exception, no such element exception. A remove method for such an iterator would have to remove the objects from the original array. So basically, again, it checks if n is less than the number of employees. If it is, then the object is saved into a variable obj. Then we shift left all of the elements from n plus one to the end of the array, number of employees. Basically, I plus one will be used to actually override the element at index I. So basically, it basically moves all of the objects one position to the left. And then when we are done, it returns the object that we removed, the last object. The standard UML class diagram to implement the iterator interface is that we have an interface aggregate, like for instance, in Java collections framework, there is the interface collection. You can have other interfaces, like for instance, list is an interface. That has to either implement another interface like iterable, or which creates an iterator. And then you have a concrete class, like a data structure, over which you basically want to get that create iterator. Now you have an iterator object, so an iterator interface with the standard methods has next, next, and remove. And then you implement a concrete iterator, like the one that we had, the payroll iterator before. It has methods for next, has next, and remove. So this is the standard way to implement the iterator interface. Okay. And one thing that we should remember for the exam are what are the standard methods for an iterator. So for an iterator, you have to implement has next, next, and remove. But I will go over a couple of more examples. So the next example, consider the following example that two different restaurants are merging. So Pancake House and Diner are merging. And you basically want to help a waitress that works for this new restaurant that resulted from the merge of the two old restaurants. And they had different menus. So Pancake House was actually storing the menus as an array. And Diner, actually Pancake House stored the menus as an array list of menu items. Diner store them as an array. Now what we want is a new iterator that iterates in a similar way over both menus, because the new waitress has to actually create a unified menu that has all of the items of Pancake House and all of the items of Diner. So we start with basically writing a common class menu that has an getiterator method. So this is the equivalent of our aggregate object, our aggregate interface. It's basically an interface menu that will be implemented by the Pancake House menu and by the Diner menu. So the Pancake House, again, keeps the foods the menu items as a list of elements, and it basically has constructors and methods to add a food to the list, because basically an array list has the method add, and also similarly to get an iterator, it returns an iterator for Pancake House. The iterator for Pancake House has a link, a reference to the list of foods and the position in this list. So it's a standard iterator of an array list. It has to implement the methods has next, and remove, because these methods are abstract in the interface iterator. So has next basically checks that the position is less than the food size, the size of that array food, and the position in that location is different than null. If it's true, it returns true, else it returns false. The next method returns basically the next food that is on the menu of Pancake House. The remove method only calls the remove method from the array, the array list that we had food. So it's quite straightforward. A diner also implements basically an array of foods, but in this case, instead of using an array list, it uses an actual array. So now we basically have methods for adding foods and getting the iterator for a diner menu. A diner iterator basically has the reference to the array of foods, the position in this array, and then it has basically the constructor for diner menu and the standard methods for iterator. Has next checks that the position is less than the length of the array food, and that position is different than null. If it's true, it returns true, otherwise it returns false. The next method returns the element is an indexed variable. It's basically an index position in food, and also increments the index with one. So it basically automatically goes to the next element next time next is called. And finally, I didn't implement remove, but it's very similar to this method that we implemented here, that you have to shift all the elements to the left and decrement the number of employees or decrement the number of foods. So I basically leave it for you to implement remove. Finally, let's assume that we have a waitress and she needs to basically give the menus for both restaurants. So this waitress basically has both menus. A print menu creates two iterators, one over the pancakes and one over the diner menu. And now in the print menu, we basically invoke either iterator in the same way. So basically iterator has next is used as a condition in a while loop, and iterator.next actually returns every item in the menu. Finally, the main method basically creates the two menus for Pancake House and Diner, and the waitress with the two different menus. Print menu will print both menus from the Pancake House and the menu and the diner. And it does it uniformly. So it basically, the garage door, I already showed you the example. Basically it does it uniformly. It shows both the menus for the Pancake House and the menu for the diner. So it's basically using it in the same way. And that's the advantage of the iterator, that basically allows you to iterate over any collection, no matter if it's an array or an array list or any other type of class. So menu item, I didn't go into details in it, but basically it's a class that stores for every item, what's the name of the item, what's the description, and if it's vegetarian or not, and the price. And it has to be included in my test if you are actually going to download and try that example. The most complicated behavioral design pattern is actually the state machine or the state design pattern. It's used to encapsulate behavior when you actually have an automata or a state machine. So when we have to model a certain automata, which may have some constraints and it's difficult to change it. So for instance, let's assume that we implement a gumball machine. You are all familiar with gumball machines. Basically, they are in stores. You have to enter some number of coins, and then you basically have to crank the gumball machine, and it will give you a gumball if there are still gumballs in the machine, or if there are no gumballs in the machine, it will take you to a state called out of gumballs. Now, modifying such a gumball machine is very complicated. So if you want to basically add another state, like for instance, that a certain number of gumballs gives you a winner level, and you basically can make two gumballs instead of one. So such a machine is hard to implement if you don't have a state design pattern, but easy if you implement a state design pattern. So you start with defining the states. So you have to basically define what are the possible states and what are the methods available for every state. So for a gumball machine state, you have insert quarter, eject quarter, tran crank, dispense gumball, and refill. And every single state that you implement has to implement these different methods. So has quarter state is a state that basically is a state in which you reach because somebody entered the quarter. So basically each one of the methods will tell you what basically happens for that specific state. So insert quarter will take you to the same state. You already inserted the quarter. Eject quarter will set the state for the current gumball machine to another state. It basically is a state transition to no quarter state. So it's a state transition, this state transition that we had a quarter and now we got back through ejection to has no quarter. So really what we see here is that we have an interface that is implemented by multiple states. And within these states, we have state transitions. So it's a standard way to implement state transitions in Java or any other programming language. So I have the has quarter state with the five different types of movements. Basically what those movements are the type of edges, refill, versus insert and eject quarters, tran cranks. So you can think about it, if this is an automata machine, these states, these actions, refill, insert, eject, turn prank, are basically state transitions, are strings that are passed in this input for the state machine. And because we have five different inputs, we have five different types of methods, basically in this interface that is a state machine. So as I said, we implement all states, has quarter state, solid state, solid out state, no quarter state, and then we implement a class that basically has everything. So we first define all of the states, basically. For each one of them, we define what's that specific state. Gumball machine has quarter state, no quarter state, sold out state, sold state, and state. And we set basically what's the current state of the gumball machine to one of these states. We have methods for actually counting how many quarters or checking if there is a quarter in the machine. We have methods for actions like dispense or trunk crank, release ball. But really what matters is the state transitions. So a gumball machine is an object that starts in state number 3, has 3 gumballs. And now the methods are called insert quarter, will change the gumball machine from no quarter to has quarter. Turn crank will change it to sold, which basically is that a gumball was basically released. Turn Crank again, it's sold out, but it's still in sold because there is no more gumball returned. Insert quarter will take now again from this state into has quarter state. And dispense will basically dispense another gumball. So really, these are methods, these are the edges that you saw in the gumball state machine. And here is an example output. So turn crank basically will give you a gumball, then it tells you to insert a quarter again, you insert a quarter, you have to turn the crank first in order to basically get another gumball and so on. A simple example for state machines are traffic lights. So a traffic light basically has three possible states, orange, red, and green. For each one of these, we create an object. Green state implements traffic light state, and it basically implements the three methods, switch green, switch orange, and switch red. And similarly, we have all of the other colors, orange and red. Now we basically have a traffic light. So a traffic light has a state. So first of all, it has the standard colors for basically red state, orange state, and green state. And then it has the current state, which is in red, let's say, at the beginning. Switching to green basically switches the, it's a method to switch the current state to green. Similarly, to switch to orange and red. Then we have the main method. In the main method, we create a new traffic light. And then we have the method to actually change states. And we switch to orange, switch to green, switch to red, switch back to orange again, but it's already there, it's already in that state, and switch to red. So really what this is a design pattern to implement a state machine. Every state has to implement the same interface. And for every one of the possible transitions labels, like release or change, switch to orange and so on, you basically have to have a method in the original interface that implements a state, okay? And that is, so the gumball machine example basically works as we saw. We start with three gumballs and we basically get two of them. And then we have the traffic light example in which I basically switch from red to green. Then we the light is switched to green. Then we switch from light to from green to orange, and we try to switch again in orange, but it's already in orange. And then we switch to red again. So really, it's a state machine, and this is a pattern of how to implement state machines. You implement them with an interface, and then every possible state implements that interface. There are many different design patterns, okay? So this refers to the state. This refers to basically the current object. Is actually, we are talking here about Java. So this refers to Java current object, okay? Okay, so there are many different design patterns. There are concurrency design patterns. We are not going to get into them, but there are monitor patterns, reactor patterns, read-write locks, scheduler patterns, active object, event-based asynchronous design patterns. Mostly these are design patterns for concurrency. There are architectural design patterns, like three-tier architectural design pattern. For instance, your project is a multi-tier design architectural design pattern is what is called a three-tier application. You have the database, you have the web server or the middle layer, and then you have the client, which in your case is basically the Chrome browser or any other browser that you have. The idea is that you should identify design patterns, and that's what I want you to be able to. If I give you a design pattern example, you should be able to identify which design pattern is used. but also use appropriately design patterns. Don't increase the complexity when it's not necessary by just using design patterns. Some languages have other patterns, but basically most of the patterns are independent of languages. I have only one more slide, which is the conclusion for this course. Basically, this is all. This semester we covered web programming in JavaScript mostly, because nowadays almost on the client side is all JavaScript. And I would assume that in the future, JavaScript will actually also conquer the server side as much as possible. I hope that this course has sparked a lot of ideas, encouraged you to write programming and exercise programming to projects. And every single time you should try to, you get a project, you should try to implement it. And thank you for taking my course, and good luck in the final. Okay. Do you have any questions? Oh, thank you very much too. And I'm sorry I didn't see you in person. It was a very good semester otherwise, but we are still in the pandemic. Hopefully now we will basically get a vaccine at some point. Thank you.
Professor, I have a quick question about the command yes. design pattern.
Go ahead.
So is the command design pattern, is it basically like you have a class that basically decides what commands should be operated? It's like a separate class, kind of?
Yes. I'm not. So basically, in most cases, the command design pattern is just a string. So like in this example, you are passing the command to a single listener as a string. But this, so basically the idea is that you have a single execution module, and that execution module gets the command as an object. You don't need to, it doesn't need to be a string, but it can be any kind of object that encodes what action to be executed. That's what the command design pattern is all about. In the second example, I actually implemented the command as actually an object. But in most cases that you will see the design pat, the command design pattern, it is a string.
Oh, so this action performed is basically, it retrieves what action is performed and then it decides which one to execute?
Exactly. Kind of? Based on the command that is passed as a parameter. Yes. Because it's a single method, but based on the input, it executes differently. It changes the color to yellow or to red. Okay, so if that is it, thank you very much. And again, good luck in your finals. And see you in the final, which is actually 2 weeks from yesterday. I will keep my office hours as usual during the semester. So my office hours will be Mondays and Wednesdays, 2:30 to 4, also during final exams. Okay, thank you. Bye, everyone.